Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick here in the U.S. Hope you guys are doing all right today, tonight, morning, whenever you might see this. I pray that the Lord will bless you and keep you in all of your ways as you would submit your life unto Him. Brothers and sisters, I had a couple of quick videos I wanted to make. Let's see. The Lord was just, speaking to me a little bit tonight. You know that we're living in the Laodicean age. For those of you who don't know that, that's the last church that the Lord gave a letter to. Revelation chapter 3. He wrote to, sent a message to seven different churches. And one of the main principles of the interpretation of the text over the last 1900 years is the fact that it's written to those individual real churches, but yet it's also really like the church ages, you know, as the church would go through these different ages until the return of the Lord. So the last church age is the lukewarm church, the Laodicean church. And I've mentioned this before, but just a quick review that in the literal city, you know, the Lord uses literal things and a play on words and all the different kind of stuff He uses in the Bible. As an example, the town of Laodicea had no natural water source, so they had this aqueduct. You know, the Romans built these aqueducts, like if you can see it in all these cities. They brought water in on this above ground thing, and it has all these arches, you know, and then it carries it in there. So there's some cities that still have those. I've seen before when I was in the army in Europe. And there's no mortar in there either. They used all these archways. And then anyway, in Laodicea, the water came from a hot spring. And so by the time it got to Laodicea, it was not hot anymore and it was not cold. It was lukewarm. So the water that literally came to that city at the time that letter was written was literally lukewarm. And the Lord used that, and that's why He chose that place, and that's why He talked about how they were lukewarm. And that's for us, the end times church. It's a lukewarm church, which we're neither hot nor cold. So the Lord would spew the end time church out of His mouth. Brothers and sisters, only that those wise virgins from Matthew 25 will enter into the rapture, brothers and sisters, enter the rapture. The rest of them will be thrown into the tribulation. And I've made tons of videos on this, going into all the details of this. And as I say, it's sad you can't repeat everything in every video. So you get new people that never heard that before. And then, I guess the computers and the internet will advance to the point, if the Lord tarries, to where, you can just cross-reference those things much more quickly. But anyway, Revelation 3:10, the Lord tells the church of Philadelphia, to that one church, because you have patiently kept my words. You have kept the word of my patience, in King James English. I will keep you out of the hour of temptation will come upon the whole earth to try all the people that live on the earth. Revelation 3:10. He didn't promise that to any church but that church. Now, as the Lord was telling each of these churches, He said, repent. Now, I could do a whole study on Laodicea, which I need to, because that's the church age we live in. You know, and I've made some videos and references to it. But the Lord, I can only, just like John the Baptist said, when his disciples came to him and said, hey, Jesus is baptizing more people than you are. And, you know, John the Baptist basically said, I'm paraphrasing, he said, you know, man, you can't have anything unless it given to you from God. And so, you know, he must increase and I must decrease. So one of the greatest things to know if you're trying to serve the Lord is you can only have what God gives you. I mean, if God gives you the wisdom and the ability and the anointing to, you know, to win, you know, to be, you know, win more people than you know, the most famous preachers that ever lived, well, great. If He doesn't anoint you and call you and put you into that, then you can't do it. You know, so we each have our own calling and the anointing and wisdom and gifting and opportunities and favor and grace that God would give us for each of our individual calling. And brothers and sisters, lots of people who are, have a form of godliness but deny the power thereof. Those old dead religion people, as I've quoted often, they love to quote the text that says, God is no respecter of persons. Now, brothers and sisters, that's for getting saved. That's for God saying, oh, I won't save you because you're black, or I won't save you because I don't like Greek people, or I won't save you because you're a woman, or you're short, or you're tall, you're fat, you're skinny. That's what it means by God's not a respecter of persons. He doesn't respect anybody more than another. To anyone who comes to Him, He will no wise cast out, it tells us in John chapter 2. Jesus said that. But, brothers and sisters, there are different callings. There are diverse gifts, various callings, various ministries in the body of Christ, whether it even be the ministry of helps, or, you know, helping people, helping the pastor, all these different kind of things, or being a pastor, mowing the grass at your church, mowing the widow next door's yard for her, and serving a widow woman who is a Christian, helping her. That's your calling, whatever it be. The point is to be faithful in what God called you to do. We must all be faithful in what God called us to do. But the verse that the Lord had stand out to me tonight, brothers and sisters, and this is what the Lord wants me to tell you, is Revelation 3, verse 20. And it's at the end of the, where the Lord is talking to the Laodicean, the lukewarm church. That's what we're living in. Verse 19, I'll read that. Jesus is speaking, "As many as I love, I rebuke and chasten." That means to chastise, to discipline. "To be zealous, therefore, and repent." Verse 20, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hear my voice and open the door, I will come in to him and will sup with him and he with me." Now, brothers and sisters, as I've said in the past on other videos, the Lord is talking to the church, to the Laodicean church, and then they won't even let the Lord in the church. And that's true. Denominations wide, as I mentioned in the video the other day, even the church I used to be an altar worker at while I was going to school, First Assembly of God in Winston-Salem, they've changed their name. All these churches, and then there's an apostolic church, you know, one of Pentecostal Oneness Church, and they're usually, you know, in hardcore as you can get, you know, to the point of legalism, and, you know, and about the Lord. And they used to have, their church was called Christ Temple. They've changed it to something else too. You know, some kind of a name that doesn't even really say like that it's a church, or they water down the names, even of the churches. You know, to let people think, like there's one, they call it, the Journey, you know, the Journey Center. Instead of saying it's a church, it's another place I know. They changed their name to the Journey Center. A journey to what? It doesn't even reference Jesus or the church or anything. So this is where it's all going. This is a Laodicean church. Even the most hardcore, supposedly spirit-filled churches all the way, of course, to the old Protestant denominations have fallen away. You know, it's the Lord. God used those old Protestant denominations in a season to bring back the revelation that, like when Martin Luther, the revelation that the Lord gave Martin Luther was the just shall live by faith, you know, and restored that portion of the gospel. And then like the Baptists, they came along, the Anabaptists, and the Lord restored the fact that you must be submerged in water, you know, to be buried with Christ and resurrected with him after you're saved. That was the part that God used them to add back to restoring the truth of the gospel. Every one of those denominations, basically, like the Methodist, God used John Wesley and those guys to restore sanctification, holiness, the holiness movement. And then, of course, Azusa Street, 1907, the Lord began to restore, the Pentecost, the gifts of the Spirit, speaking in tongues, prophecy, interpretation, all those things, 1 Corinthians chapter 12. The Lord is continually restoring his church. And then you have a remnant, brothers and sisters. You have a remnant. In every one of those churches, there's a remnant. God has his people everywhere. But the vast majority of people, sad to say, are your tares. They come in to try to overshadow and beat down and control God's wheat everywhere. And that's what God sent me for, brothers and sisters. My ministry is to the wheat and to rebuke the tares. Now, the problem is you got people like in the middle. Let's give an example, the most famous one, Joel Osteen, trying to be a people pleaser, trying to entertain the tares. We cannot entertain the tares, brothers and sisters. That's the, you know, that's the where the axe meets the grindstone in my ministry. You know, I'm not a wet nurse. There are lots of preachers who are wet nurses. You know, they give the milk and they try to old coddle and, oh, if we're going to be salt and light, maybe we can save some of these tares and, you know, and all this kind of, you know, touchy-feely stuff. And everybody's got their calling to be a wet nurse. And a wet nurse is one, you know, that gives milk to the master's children, you know, to the boss's child. So, of course, the people belong to the Lord. Is our master. And then the wet nurses will come in and breastfeed, you know, and give a little baby milk to people. My brothers and sisters, you know, thank God, you know, Lord called me to be a drill sergeant, you know. I'm a drill sergeant in the army of the Lord, and sometimes I'm a berserker in the army of the Lord. You know, and praise God for that. We all have our different callings. I can be a berserker. I can be a drill sergeant. And on a rare occasion, if the Lord puts the power of his anointing on me, he can use me as a wet nurse on a rare occasion. I mean, it's all up to him. You know, I've been through seasons where I did that when I planted those Filipino churches in the United States. I was in wet nurse mode, but it was all by the power of the Holy Spirit. It wasn't my personality, but only under the anointing of the Holy Spirit. So people, you know, they get confused. You know, they want a pastor that's going to say and do what they want to do. You know, they want someone that's a wet nurse. And then they, you know, there are people who try to tell me, oh, you need to be more. No, I don't need to be like any other preacher. I need to be as what God wants me to be. He uses each of our personalities. Just like when you read the Bible, it's not the Lord doesn't dictate and mind control the people who wrote the Bible. If you read the writings of each of the apostles, you can see their personality is in there too, but yet they're inspired by God. They're not controlled like a robot by God. They're inspired. God breathed. So that's the difference. You're breathed by God. Like Muhammad, as an example, Muhammad, when he dictated the Quran, he says that, I mean, that the witnesses said that he would have convulsions and seizures. He became possessed and he was totally taken over by this spirit that dictated the Quran. You can read the writings of the people who were there, who wrote it down for him and all this, because Muhammad couldn't read and write. The people, his scribes and all that, and his followers, they wrote down his reaction with the people that wrote the Bible, they didn't get possessed. They didn't get overtaken to the point where there was no longer there. You know, God shines his light through. He takes the best of our personalities and character traits, and then he, you know, lifts up those good character traits, and then he pushes down our flesh nature. And then what's in us, you know, he magnifies that, whatever it may be. So we all have different gifts and talents and different callings and all over the body of Christ, and the Lord uses it in his way. And so anyway, I always weave my messages together in a kind of a, what is the right word, in an abstract way. But what I'm trying to get at, brothers and sisters, is the Lord wants to come in and sup with each of us, brothers and sisters. As I read from that verse, Revelation 3:20, behold, I stand at the door and knock. That's Jesus. If any man hear my voice and open the door, I will come in with into him and will sup with him and he with me. So the Lord told me to make this video, and he's making an offering to you. I mean, of course, it's already in the Bible. It's a rhema word. There's the logos, which means the Bible. And Jesus is the logos. He's the word. The Bible is the logos. But a rhema is a word from the word. A rhema is a, as an example, it's a quickened Bible verse or Bible text to someone of God's people. That's a rhema word, a now word, a word from the Lord. And that's the text that the Lord gave me. He told me to tell you, for all of us, invite him in. Now, I'm not talking about salvation. That's also true. But in this text, brothers and sisters, in this context, it's my calling and anointing as a drill sergeant. I'm not talking necessarily evangelism here. I'm talking to Christians and discipleship and growth in each Christian's heart. And the Lord wants you to invite him. The Lord is telling me to tell you, if you invite him into your life, into your heart, surrender all those places of your heart. And I mean, I'm talking about not just salvation. I'm not talking about saying a sinner's prayer. I'm talking about all of those corners of your heart that you have held back from the Lord, whatever it may be, those parts of your heart. Jesus, you know, talks about forgiveness, and that specifically was coming into my mind from the Lord. Unforgiveness. Jesus said, you know, if you don't forgive others, the Father won't forgive you. You know, Jesus tells the parable because Peter asked him, how many times should I forgive somebody? 7 times. And Jesus said, no, I tell you 7 times, 70 times. You know, and then Jesus tells the parable of the master who, you know, he has a servant who owes him a big debt. Let's just say it's $1,000 as an example. And then he tells the guy, you know, I'm going to put you in jail. And the guy starts begging him, please, can you forgive me of this debt? And as soon as I get the money, I'll pay you back. You know, please don't put me in jail. Please forgive me. And then the master says, okay, I'll forgive you of your $1,000 debt. You don't even have to pay me back. Forget about it. Don't worry about it. Everything's cool. Then that servant goes out and he sees another servant who owes him $1. And he tells the other servant, hey, you owe me my $1. If you don't pay me, I'm going to put you in jail. And then, you know, the other servant's begging him, please forgive me of the $1. I'll pay you back later as soon as I get the money and all that. Just like what he did, the first servant did. And then he says, no, I'm going to throw you in jail. And then the other servants hear and tell the master, hey, you know, the guy you just forgave $1,000, now he's trying to put a fellow servant in jail for a debtor's prison for $1. And so the master finds out. He calls the first servant in. Attention, all you once saved, always saved people. He's mad. He's wroth. He's angry with that servant. He said, I forgave you of all that debt. And then you won't forgive this guy that, you know, I forgave you, owe me $1,000. You won't forgive the guy that owes you $1. It says he cast him into prison. And he says, don't let him out till he pays me back everything he owes me. Now, brothers and sisters, I didn't really want to get into that topic, but the Lord, because what he called me to do, to be a drill sergeant for him, a berserker for him on occasion, this case a drill sergeant, that's a great example of once saved, always saved, and how that doctrine of saying a sinner's prayer one time, being forgiven of your sins like the first servant, and then because you didn't forgive didn't obey, live in obedience by forgiving others, then the master calls you back in, even though he already forgave your debt. Then he says, this time, I'm unforgiving your debt. Now you owe me that debt, and I'm putting you in prison until you pay me back everything you owe me. So of course we can never pay back the Lord for our sins. You know, we can't pay back our sins. So therefore, what does that mean in connection with once saved, always saved? Is there some meaning there when the Lord says, if you don't forgive other people, the Father won't forgive you from your heart? If you don't forgive other people from your heart, the Father won't forgive you? That's in the same text that I'm quoting from. That's from the Gospel of Matthew. Can you tell me how that jives with once saved, always saved? I love to hear people, talk about walking a mile for a camel. They'll walk 100 miles to try to twist and turn and all this. They'll switch over to philosophical ideas and thoughts about, and all of these. They'll start making up their own parables, totally unrelated, to try to explain away what the Lord is trying to tell us. God bless you guys, brothers and sisters. I've been changing my schedule. Just tell you, because there's several times people ask me, Brother Patrick, how do you have time to do all the things you're doing? Well, what I've been doing is actually I've been staying up 1 hour later every day. I've been doing 25-hour day. But I got, to a point where I'm going around the clock here. So, brothers and sisters, I'm trying to get back on going to bed, at an early time in the evening, getting up in the morning. And so I'm going around the clock, gaining 1 hour a day, till I can get back so that I have time to do all the things the Lord called me to do. But praise God. I'm praying for all you guys who asked me to pray for you. People ask me for a word. Some people I'm giving private words. Haven't done a word video in a while. I'm just waiting on the Lord. Because there's the majority of people, brothers and sisters, and not you, of course, or me, right? But there are people, brothers and sisters, who run into and fro looking for a word. The same ones that run and want to see a video about a vision of the rapture, and then they're probably not even going to go in the rapture because, they're not even interested in anything about discipleship. They're not interested in anything about the Word of God. They're only interested in when's the rapture. And those are the very people, brothers and sisters, the very people that's probably going to be left behind. They're not serious. They're a mile wide and an inch deep, and they're always looking for that wet nurse. They're always looking for the wet nurse. Brothers and sisters, I had a vision about the rapture. I'm going to make a separate video about it. And it's a pretty good deal, and the Lord reminded me of it. And I made a video of it about 2 or 3 years ago, and the Lord is bringing it back to my memory. So praise God. Maybe it's going to happen soon. Anyway, God bless you guys. I love you guys. There's no substitute for the great fellowship I have had on YouTube. And as I mention all the time, there's always that 1% of, vile people, who are, God haters and all kinds of wackiness. But, I thank God 99% of the people I dealt with is just awesome, great brothers and sisters in Christ. And I want to thank each and every one of you who's been a brother and sister in Christ to me, and given to Joshua's ministry and given to help me with my travels and have given me sound advice and prayers. And I ask you guys to pray for the orphanages. As the government, is doing kind of do some inspections and stuff, even though we have separation of church and state in the Philippines, they're still, the Philippines is very corrupt at the lowest level. Unlike the U.S., it's corrupt at the highest level with the political action committees and all that and lobbying. Philippines is corrupt on a local level. And so we have local political officials who are looking for a little special fees. And, thank the Lord we haven't had any trouble in the past. But now they're sniffing around, smelling around, looking at how well our buildings are, trying to calculate in their little evil minds how much they think that we should give them as some kind of a bribe. So I ask you guys to pray about that. And, the Bible says to get along with people as much as you're able to. So, I don't have a problem paying a special permit fee to a certain point, but I prefer not to. But I'm not going to, jeopardize the orphanages for $20, if that's what it is. But I ask you guys to pray about that we'll have favor with them and that the Lord will, that they would get saved or that the Lord would silence them and have them not trying to make any, you know, take it, you know, steal. They're wanting to steal from the Lord, basically. So ask you guys for God to give the wisdom and everything that we need, and the favor to handle this situation properly. Whatever the Lord would have us do is what we want to do. So God bless you guys. I love you guys. Thank you very much.